Thank you for listening to Life Worship Center, 1604 Golden Springs Road. For more information about our church, visit us on the web at www.lifewc.org. And now, today's sermon.
We're talking about generosity. We're talking about growing in generosity. We're talking about being generous. Can I ask you a question? If you would, just raise your hand. Would you want to be considered as a generous person? Raise your hand if you would. Hope most of us. How many knows what the opposite of generous is? Stingy. Does anybody want to be stingy?
No,
we don't want to be stingy. If you'll bear with me for a moment, let me tell you a little joke I heard. And if you don't know why I said bear with me, you probably will after I tell it. I heard about a farmer who came to the church office. He walked up to the secretary of the church. He said, "I want to see the head hog." The secretary said, "Sir, if you're talking about our beloved minister, you may call him reverend, or you may call him pastor, but I don't think it would be proper to refer to him as the head hog." "Well, all right," the farmer said. "I just sold a few pigs. Going to donate $10,000 to the building fund, so I was hoping to catch it." "Oh, just a minute," she said. "Let me see if Porky's in his office." Perception about preachers that are greedy, churches that abuse and are not good stewards, televangelists that are wolves in sheep's clothing. It's those kind of things that make it challenging for someone to preach with boldness what God says about money. But I'm going to tell you something. I stand before you today. I am not a greedy person. I know. And I've never been accused of being anything like a televangelist. I don't have the hair. I don't have the voice. I don't even have good preacher clothes, y'all. And so that is not who I am. But I do know what God says about money. And he says a lot. And he never shied away from being bold about the subject of giving, about the subject of money. And I pray today that I can walk in his footsteps and speak with authority into our lives about what Jesus has to say, about what God has to say, about what his word says concerning money. Now, there is one foundational passage, I believe, in the New Testament that really should be our foundation when it comes to New Testament giving. And it is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. So if you want to turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 9 or follow along in our notes or look at the screen, I would suggest to you as homework you would go back and read chapter 8 as well, because chapter 8 and chapter 9 deal with giving in the New Testament church. Who's living in the New Testament? Come on, raise your hand. We're living in the New Testament today. Let me get a little sip of water here. I'm reading out the New King James Version today, 2 Corinthians chapter 9, starting in verse 6. "But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity. For God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. As it is written, he has dispersed abroad, he has given to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now may he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food supply and multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness while you are enriched in everything for all liberality which causes thanksgiving through us to God. For For the administration of this service not only supplies the needs of the saints, but also is abounding through many thanksgivings to God. While through the proof of this ministry, they glorify God for the obedience of your confession to the gospel of Christ, and for your liberal sharing with them and all men, and by their prayer for you, who long for you because of the exceeding grace of God in you. Thanks be to God for his indescribable gift. Amen. So let's get into this. Generosity, you all raised your hand, or most of you, I didn't count, but most of you raised your hand and said, I want to be a generous person. I want you to know first off today that generosity comes from your heart. Generosity comes from your heart. The passage I just read to you, it said, let each one give as he purposes in his heart. Say heart. Not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. There's a story told of a beggar that was on the roadside. He was asking for alms, and he was asking for things. Alexander the Great passed by. And this man was so poor, he was so wretched, he didn't even have the right to lift up a needy hand in the face of Alexander the Great. Yet Alexander the Great took some gold coins and threw them out to the beggar. The servant who was with Alexander the Great said, sir, copper coins would adequately meet a beggar's need. Why would you give him gold? And Alexander responded to him in royal fashion. He said, copper coins would suit the beggar's need, but gold coins suit Alexander's giving. You see, the Bible tells us that a generous heart, a generosity comes from the heart, and we are to give not out of necessity, but out of a generous heart. And so if God has brought you to the place that giving for you should be a goal, do not give copper. Do you understand what I'm saying? If God has given you a place, generous things into your life, if God has blessed you in such a way, and may I say this, and I'm going to say this probably a few times today, generosity is not limited to people who have a lot. Someone who may be considered poor, someone who says, I have very little, can be just as generous as a billionaire. Because generosity is measured by the heart and how you give. There's an African proverb that says, it is the heart that gives, the fingers just let go. It's the heart that gives, the fingers just let go. You see, I want you to know today that you should give what God says for you to give. You should have a heart that is receptive to God, to listen for his voice, and simply give what he says you should give. If you're a couple, if you're a husband and wife, you should pray together. You should seek God together. And you should purpose between both of you in agreement and unity what we should give unto the Lord. Now, this is your first time with us today. You probably think the pastor preaches on money every week. That's not the truth. Those of you that know me know that's not the truth. I've been pastoring for almost 14 years. I'm almost 40, not yet. And I've almost been pastoring 14 years, but not yet. In 1 month, we'll get both of those down. But in 14 years, I'm fixing to say something to you that I've never said in 14 years. And we've got, and I'm looking around, we've got a couple people here that's heard me from the very first day I ever started preaching. What I'm fixing to say I've never said before. As I was preparing this message this week, God dropped into my heart this right here. He said, there's going to be someone, and I don't know if it's at Golden Springs or at Saks. And I don't know if it's one or several. But he said, there's going to be someone that as you give the word, God is going to speak into someone's heart a challenge to give something huge. It's quiet, isn't it? I pushed it aside. I said, I kept studying. God came back into my spirit and said the same thing. He said, I'm going to challenge someone to give something that when I first tell them, they're going to they're going to do the same thing you did. They're going to try to push it away. But as the word continues to come in, they're going to be challenged to do something they've never done before. I'm going to tell you something. It may be someone that has a lot of resources and you're going to write a huge check. Or it may be something that has very little and what you give is going to be huge to you. I don't know what it is. I just know I got to say it because it's inside of me. And any of you, raise your hand if you've heard me from the very beginning. I'm sure it's Sharice here. Anybody else here? My wife, of course. Anyone? We've got at least two. Would y'all, Charlotte? Yes. Would y'all, have I ever said that before? Have I ever said anything like that? For that's not who I am. But he dropped it into my heart that God's going to challenge someone to do something, step out of your comfort, and to do something you've never done before. Do what God says. The scripture tells us you cannot force generosity. You cannot force generosity. Generosity must come from the heart. There was a movie that starred Burt Reynolds in it many, many years ago. And in the movie, he decides to commit suicide by swimming out as far as he could go, and then until he got exhausted, and then just go under the water. And that's what he was going to do. So he swims out as far as he can go, and then he starts to go under. And as he goes under, he looks up, and he can see the surface of the water, and he decides, I don't want to die. I want to live. I want to live. So then he tries to begin to swim to the shore, but it's a very, very long way off. And as he begins to swim, he talks to God. He makes some promises to God. He promises that he's going to obey all the Ten Commandments. And then he realizes he doesn't know what all the Ten Commandments are. And so he promises, Lord, if you get me out of this, I'll learn the Ten Commandments. And then I'll obey all the Ten Commandments. And then in his panic, he says, Lord, if you get me out of this, I will give you 80% of everything that I have. But as time passes by, and he's still going okay, and he can just start begin to see the shoreline. He says, Lord, if you help me get to the shore, I'll give you 10% of everything I have. And finally struggles to the place where then he sees and knows that he's going to be able to make it. And he said, Lord, let's just forget about what I said before. I think I can make it on my own now. You cannot force a generous heart. That's what this scripture tells us. It says it can't be with a grudge. It can't be out of necessity. I want to say it cannot be out of fear. Fear will not produce generosity. A preacher that causes you to be afraid in order to give is robbing you of the opportunity to be generous. You've lost that opportunity. Guilt will not make you generous. Shame will not make you to be generous. Intimidation will not make you to be, it may cause you to give a big offering, but you've lost your opportunity to be generous. Generosity must come from your heart. See, because none of those things, fear, guilt, shame, intimidation, none of those things can produce cheerfulness. If I had a gun and pointed it at you, if I had a gun and pointed it at Oakley, I said, Oakley, be cheerful. Smile. Laugh. He might force a smile. He might even chuckle through the tears. But he won't have a cheerful heart. His heart will be filled with fear. We can't force this. This is a heart issue. God says give with a cheerful heart. And don't be like the little girl who her mom gave a $5 bill and a $1 bill and said, I want you to give one of these in the offering. The offering plate came by and she looked at both of them and she was contemplating and she couldn't decide which one to give. Finally, she put the $1 in and put the $5 in her pocket. And her mama got her home, and her mama said, I'm proud of you that you gave today. I'm so proud that you gave it. Can I ask why you gave the one instead of five? And she said, Mama, I just really couldn't decide. And I got to thinking about what the preacher said. And the preacher said that God loves a cheerful giver. And I knew I'd be a whole lot more happier if I kept the $5. That's not what it's talking about. It's talking about praying to God with a cheerful heart, excited, generous, to do something that God has given you the ability to do. Let's move on. Generosity is from the heart. Generosity is faith-driven. Man, I sounded like Porky Pig today. I should have started off with that joke. You can't be generous without faith. Our scripture tells us that God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you, having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. Generosity is faith-driven. You can be generous if you trust God. You can. It's not hard to be generous when you believe God, when you believe what He has said. You can be generous. This lady was teaching the Sunday school class, and she began to ask them, they were talking about giving and missions, and she had a bunch of 10-year-olds, she had 18-year-olds, and she asked them, she said, would you guys be willing to give $1 million to missionaries? And they all screamed, yes, we would do it. Would you give $1,000? They all screamed, yes, we would do it. She said, would you give $100? They said, yes, we would do it. She said, would you give just $1 to missionaries? And all of them said yes, but one, his name was Johnny. Let's let Sandy get that out of her system. Johnny, I'm sorry. Look, if you've ever noticed, most of these little stories like that, the boy's always named Johnny. So I'm just, I'm not picking on him. The boy's always Johnny. Little Johnny. And Little Johnny just sounds better. Right? Little Richard, Little Harry. Little Johnny's just sounds better for us. Would you just give $1? And they all said yes, except for Little Johnny. Little Johnny didn't raise his hand. And the teacher said, Johnny, why didn't you say yes this time? He said, Little Johnny said, well, because I have $1. I say yes to $1 million. I say yes to $1,000, not $100, but I got $1, so I can't say yes to $1. You can't be generous without faith. And God is not, I'll repeat it, God is not asking you to give something you don't have. God is asking you to be generous with what you have. It'd be easy to be generous with $1 million if you don't have $1 million and just say, I would do it. But can you do it with $1? Can you do it with $10? Can you do it with what you have? Are you willing to be generous with what God has given you stewardship over? It's not just for the rich. For all of us. A church meeting was going on and a very wealthy man rose to tell the rest of the people there at the church about his Christian faith. He said, I'm a millionaire. And I attribute it all to the rich blessings of God in my life. He said, I remember the turning point in my faith. I had just earned my first dollar. I went to a church meeting that night. The speaker was a missionary who told about his work. He said, I knew that I only had $1 bill, and I had to either give it all to God's work or nothing at all. So at that moment, I decided to give everything I had. I gave my whole dollar to God, and I believe that God blessed that decision, and that's why I am a rich man today. He finished, and there was an awed silence at his testimony as he moved toward his seat. As he sat down, the little old lady sitting in the pew behind him tapped him on the shoulder and said, I dare you to do it again. Now that would be difficult, wouldn't it? That's why I say generosity is very equal from those that have little to those that have much. Someone that has much can give something, and to those that have little, they would say, what a huge gift, when God is looking down and saying, you're not being generous. Not with what I put in your life, you're not being generous. God sat outside the temple, and he watched his people. The Bible says he watched how they gave. Go back and read it. He watched how they gave. And that little woman came by, and she gave 2 mites. It was everything she had. Jesus took notice at someone with great generosity. It won't happen without faith. Somebody answer this question today. What is better, a Dodge or a Mercedes? Dodge. Carlos. I'm going to go sit by little Johnny back there. Okay. What car costs the most? A Dodge or a Mercedes? I understand you got a Dodge. We love it, Carlos. But if you had, the Mercedes would be nice, right? If they made a good truck, Mercedes. Okay. Let me make this more simple for people like Carlos and Anita this morning. What is better, $100 or $10,000? Carlos. Carlos says $10,000, and he can fix his Dodge. What is better? You said when we started, you want to be generous. Now I know you enough to know that you believe what God says. Amen. You believe the word of God is true. You wouldn't be here if you didn't. Jesus said in Acts chapter 20, it is better to give than to receive. Do you believe God's word? Do you? Do you believe what God says? If you believe God's word, then you have to believe that giving is better than receiving. Then may I ask you, why are you still unwilling to be generous to the Lord? 80% of the church, not our church, but the church as a whole, 80% of the church, and it's just estimated, but 80% of the church do not even give 10% of their income to the Lord. And 10% was an old covenant standard. 10% was what caused God to say in the book of Malachi that you've been robbing from me the tithe and the offerings. And we are a new covenant people that's been overwhelmed and had grace poured upon us in such favor. And that Jesus shows us through his teachings that we are not limited to the Old Testament law, but even by grace, I believe that we're called to a higher calling. The old covenant said, do not commit adultery. Jesus said, I tell you, don't think about it in your heart, because in your heart you've already done it. And so I believe that grace calls us to a higher standard. So if you ask me if I believe in the tithe, I want to tell you in my own personal belief, I believe I've got to start there. In my own personal opinion, I must start there. But I believe that God has called us to a generosity that rises above a legal standard. 80% of the church do not even give 10% of their income to the work of God. That means that the church in a whole operates on 20% for missions, to keep the lights on, to do the work of God, to help the poor. 20% the church operates on. I'm not very good at math, but I think the church could do a whole lot more for God if we had 80% more. Instead of having 20%, if we had 100% of people, and it's not asking 100% of people to be humongous givers, it's asking 100% of people to trust God with what he says in his word, that is more blessed to give than to receive, and to know that if you are generous, God in return is generous to you. It's just simply asking the people of God to walk and not just talk, but walk as the people of God. Right. It's good stuff. I think we could do a whole lot more life with 80% more. Right. Oh, man. I just started thinking about it. See, none of you have to turn people down when they come for help. I do. When I have to, it hurts. When we have it, it's one of the best feelings ever. A genuine, sincere need that we can be a part of, that we can help a missionary that needs something additional or trying, and we have it to be able to meet that need. It's one of the best feelings I have as a pastor, to be able to meet those needs. One of the worst feelings I ever have is to say, we don't have it. And to know that 80% of the church still have not stepped into that generous spirit. of trusting God and obeying His Word, that makes the feeling even worse, because you know what? We've got that 80% right here. We've got it right here. It's just still in your pocket. You're holding on to it. Because even though you say, I want to be generous, you're acting like you want to be stingy. Generosity just makes sense. Just makes sense. That's what this passage tells us. He goes on to say that may he who supplies seed to the sower. That's pretty good right there. We could preach right there. God supplies seed to the sower. He doesn't promise to provide seed to the one who won't sow. But God says if you'll be a sower, He'll provide seed so that you can sow. And ultimately, let me step out of here, all right? Because the televangelist may say, if you'll sow seed, God will make you a millionaire. God will make sure you have a Mercedes instead of a Dodge. God will bless you in an extraordinary way if you'll just sow the seed. The Bible doesn't say that. The Bible says if you'll sow seed, God will make sure you have more seed to sow. Because God knows that the best, the most, the biggest blessing you could ever have in your life is to be able to help when people need help and be able to do when people need it done. To have the resources in your life to sow into other people's lives. And God is saying the secret to being that person. Because there's no one more happy than the person that's able to give, that's able to bless others, that's able to make a difference in someone else's life. And God says the secret to being that person is to sow what you have, and He will put grain back in your bag, pressed down, shaken together, overflowing. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food, supply and multiply, say multiply. Multiply the seed you have sown and increase the fruits of your righteousness while you are enriched in everything for all liberality. Corrie Ten Boom said the measure of a life is not its duration, but its donation. She also said, I have held many things in my hand. And I have lost them all. But whatever I have placed in God's hands, that I still possess. Everything that you keep is all that you're going to ever have. Just think about that. Everything you keep is all you'll ever have. You are limited by what you keep. As a matter of fact, generosity is not measured by what you give, but by what you keep. You are limited by what you keep, but everything that you give has the ability to be multiplied. So we can choose to keep, and that's all we got, or we can choose to be generous and allow God to multiply that which we give. God says, not Jonathan, God says that the amount you sow will be proportional to the amount that you reap. And I don't care how many preachers have abused that or twisted it. We're not talking about them today. We're talking about what the Word of God says today. He says if you sow sparingly, you will reap sparingly. But if you sow generously, you will reap generously. God's Word. I'm going to try to bring this to a close. Andrea, where's Andrea? If you will, just play something for us. And you can begin to play as soon as you get there. That's fine. You're not going to disturb me or bother me. Just go right ahead and play some music. We appreciate Andrea playing for us this morning. Let me drop this into your spirit. Shortly after World War II came to a close, Europe began picking up the pieces. Much of the old country had been ravaged by war. It was in ruins. But one of the saddest sights of all was little orphaned children that were starving in the streets of the war-torn cities. Early on a chilly morning, an American soldier was making his way back to his barracks in London. And as he turned the corner in his Jeep, he spotted a little boy with his nose pressed to the window of a pastry shop. Inside, the cook was kneading dough for a fresh batch of dumplings. The hungry boy stared in silence, watching every move. The soldier pulled his Jeep to the curb. He stopped, he got out, and watched quietly where the little boy was standing. Through the steamed-up window, he could see the mouth-watering morsels as they were being pulled from the oven, popping hot. David, if you'll just bear with me, I know you don't want to hear about donuts. David's been working at Krispy Kreme. Spare me. I think about that and start telling the story. The boy salivated and released a slight groan as he watched the cook place him onto the glass enclosed counter. The soldier's heart went out to the little orphan boy as he stood beside him. He said, "Son, would you like some of those?" The boy said, "Oh, yes, I would love some." The American stepped inside and bought a dozen, put them in a bag, and walked back to where the little boy was standing in the foggy cold of the London morning. He smiled, he held out the bag, and he simply said, "Here, here you are." As he turned to walk away, he felt a tug on his coat, and he looked back, and he heard the little boy ask him. He said, "Mister, are you God? You are never more like God than when you're generous." Do you understand that? You want to walk like him? As believers, we do. We want to imitate Christ. You are never more like Christ than when you're generous. You know what? Healing the sick, casting out demons, those are mighty powerful things that everybody wants to be a part of or know that they played some role in. Jesus really didn't lift those things up too high. Jesus said, "Did you visit those that were in jail? Did you put clothes on the people who didn't have any?" Did you show generosity to the least of these? You've never been more like Jesus than when you're generous. I just want to wait a moment. Carlos, good brother, just set our offering buckets out. This is, we normally take our offering at the end of a sermon. And here for the last few weeks, we've been bringing it instead of coming to you. I want us to do that again today. As we get ready to do this morning, I want to say again, whatever God, not the preacher, whatever God prompts you in your heart to do, do it. No matter how big it seems to you, huge, life-changing, something you've never done before, maybe you've never given before, and you feel the tug in your heart. Maybe you've never been a consistent giver. Maybe today you hear God call and you say, "Come on, it's time to be generous. It's time to give God the opportunity. It's time to trust Him. It's time to trust Him." Today, for the first time, you could say, "God, I'm going to be consistent. Today's the first day." Maybe some of you today, you need to go home and talk to your husband, wife. You guys need to pray together and say, "Look, we've been leaving this out. This is important. This is important. We got to get on the same page here. We've got to do this." Maybe you're wrestling with what God is telling you to do. I'd say when you leave this place today, find somewhere, hear God's voice. Know that He's saying it. Know that He's speaking into your life. Do not be afraid. Whether you have little or you have much, I just want to say to you, do not be afraid to do what God asked you to do. If you choose to live a life of generosity, you will never, ever, ever regret it. No one has ever or will ever walk through the pearly gates of heaven and say, I wish I hadn't given so much. I believe that if today was my last day and I entered into heaven, I believe I would say, why didn't I give more? So why can't we start today? Why can't we renew our hearts today to be generous unto the Lord? I don't know what maybe the enemy might say. The church needs a special offering. The pastor needs no. God has never failed to take care of us. This is not about us. It's not about me. It's about you and your heart. You may not even belong to this church. You're just visiting today. You go to church somewhere else and God is saying to you today, hey, you go be generous to your church. You go be generous to the work of God where God has placed you. It's not about our church. It's not. Not at all. You may be watching online right now from Pennsylvania or Washington or wherever. You just happen to come on to the live stream that you're watching right now, wherever you are. I'm not telling you God's saying to send a check to Life Worship Center. I'm telling you that God is saying to be generous. Have a generous heart. Trust God. Trust God. He will not disappoint you. As we all stand, I'm going to go to the Lord in prayer. And then we're going to give like we've done every week for the last several weeks. As a part of our worship, this is our worship. How many of you would say, I want God to love the way I worship? Right? All of us. How many would say, I want God to love the way I serve Him? Right? All of us. How many would say, I want God to love the way I treat people? All of us would say that. Would you also say, I want God to love the way I give? Because that's what our scripture says. It says God loves a cheerful giver. It's not saying that God only loves people that are cheerful. It's telling you that God loves the way you give when it is at a generous heart and with a cheerful spirit. So I'm going to lead us in a prayer. We're going to come and give today to the Lord, trusting Him. Trusting Him. Trusting Him. Heavenly Father, I just come before you this morning. I've spoken what you wanted me to speak. God, you've spoken to my own heart. Lord, let me have an attitude, heart of generosity, of faith. We can trust you. I pray that right now, God, that you would be penetrating the hearts of your people with the voice and power of your Holy Spirit to be generous. I believe, God, that you're just waiting to pour seed into the lives of those who are willing to sow. Just let us all. Let us be not the norm. Let our church not be the church that has 20%. Let our church be the church that has 100%. I don't think that's too difficult. I don't think that's too difficult to ask that all of us be obedient to God's call in our lives to be generous. So this is my prayer. This is my plea. Speak to us now, Holy Spirit. In Christ's name, I pray. Amen. And amen. As Andrea plays something for us this morning, this is your time to come and worship. Give it to the Lord.
For listening to Life Worship Center, 1604 Golden Springs Road, where we are proclaiming the way, the truth, and the life. For more information about our church, visit us on the web at www.lifewc.org.